said, this will be a working lunch. So I have the honor and privilege of introducing our next two speakers who are presenting. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Steve Trippenfeldis. I'm the principal at Munster High School. And actually, our two guest speakers are going to be talking about some concurrent enrollment and other issues there. I'd like to give you a brief little story. I promise it'll be brief. When I took over at Munster High School, didn't know much about concurrent enrollment. And a few years into, as a principal, my assistant principal, Dr. Gilworth, who's here, walks up and says, you know, we don't have as many dual credit courses at that time, I think, is what we used to call them, as we probably should. And she took a look at our enrollment types of courses and the coursework that we had, and that some of you probably have and probably are ready to go right now. She took a really close look at that, and I think from 1 year we went from maybe a handful to over 20 concurrent enrollment courses that we could offer our students through Purdue North Central and Ivy Tech. Interesting enough, that's where the two speakers are from, and I'm very close to my heart. These are two universities that work very well with high schools, work extremely well with us to try to provide concurrent enrollment. And I'd like to introduce our two speakers. I won't say much about them except that you can definitely read about them in their bios. But the first one is Paul McGinnis, who's the Vice Chancellor of Enrollment Management and Student Services at Purdue North Central. Wonderful person to work with. Personally know that from what our guidance department has done to help with getting concurrent enrollment. Just so you know, Paul serves on a couple committees at the Indiana Commission of Higher Ed. And they're committees where a lot of things are talked about. One of them is the Indiana Commission of Higher Education Statewide Articulation Committee, the Indiana Commission of Higher Ed's Core Transfer Library, which is incredibly important to us at the high school level, and also the Indiana Commission of Higher Education's Transfer Indiana Center Office Committee as well. The other speaker that's going to be with us is Dr. Margaret Semmer. Dr. Semmer is the Vice Chancellor of Academic Affairs at the Ivy Tech Community College, Northwest Indiana. She's also worked at Joliet Junior College, Moraine Valley Community College, I do believe. She has been an adopter, advocate, and leader of dual credit implementation throughout her career. And I'd like to introduce both of them from Ivy Tech and Purdue North Central. And we'll go with that.
Thank you very much, and hopefully you're enjoying the conference so far, and hopefully I can meet your expectations. And what I'll try to do is try to keep this informal as possible. I know many of you in the room, some of you I don't know. I've got a PowerPoint that I'm going to do. I've been given this 15-minute allotment, so what I'm going to do is split that out and give some of it to a co-worker of mine, and she's actually going to go online. We're going to access through our firewall. I think we're just going to go through the public website instead of the firewall, and you can log on. We'll log on just like a student would. But I'll go ahead and get started. And what we're focusing on today is concurrent enrollment, in particular, the vehicles for advisement. Brief background of the university. We started in 1948. We moved to Westville. We were in the Barker Mansion in Michigan City. Then we moved to Westville in 1965. We're one of five campuses in the system. And we, in the fall, we had about 2,400, almost 2,500 concurrent enrollment students for nearly 13,500 credit hours. So when you talk about large programs, we have grown beyond probably our wildest expectations, and through that process we've also been committed to the rigor and standards that need to take place. Currently we're offering about 45 different courses, and as Steve mentioned, Munster offers over 20 of them. We're in about 46 high schools in 11 counties statewide, and we were approached by some others, by Fort Wayne, and we said no. At some point we can't get our faculty out there to do on-site visits, classroom visits, and things like that. So under the current constraints, we're kind of just sticking around in this area. Although with the web and some of the technologies, who knows what the future might bring. When we first started, it was called the Superior High School Student Program. And that was mainly the students would come to our campus. And at that time, I think there was a bit of legislation in Indiana called Rule 10, which meant that the students needed to complete at least 4 semesters in high school, in other words, be a junior before they could actually enroll on your campus. I think there was probably maybe one program that we did off campus, and it was through a grant with AT&T, and actually that fell through, and we ended up just driving our instructor out. But in 2006, we started with one high school and 14 students, and then once again, we're at 46 high schools and roughly 2,500 students. We did get full accreditation with the National Alliance of Concurrent Enrollment Partnerships, that's NACEP, and that is a 5-year process that you have to be in place, running courses at a certain level with certain assessment measures, and then you go through a pretty arduous process. It took us about a year just of the assessment, where we had to do 5-year out surveys, 2-year out surveys, 1-year out surveys, surveys the counselors, and other components, and thankfully we did very well, and we actually just got our accreditation back several months ago. For our students now in the high schools, we do look for certain admissions criteria. We look for at least a 3.0 on a 4 scale, or at least a 15 or higher, or 21 on the ACT. So what we're not trying to do at this point is interjects probably interventions for students that maybe are more in the middle or at the lower end of academic readiness. Currently, the tuition is about an 85% savings to the students in Indiana through the legislation that mandated the preferred courses at $25. And from what I understand from the state, I think they're going to be looking at introducing now the technology courses, the CET courses, probably will be on a new list, and those also will be offered at $25. And you'll see an expansion of the core transfer library as a result of that. So about 2 years ago, we changed the core transfer library and we expanded it, where we brought in 6 different academic panels. And probably what will happen is we'll introduce a 7th panel to look at technology. The Board of Trustees set rate for the non-priority courses is about 101 and change. And then if you were an undergraduate student coming in, it would be $214.65. And it doesn't include the student fees, lab fees, or books. When we think about the core transfer library, it kind of gives your counselors and our advisors a framework to operate under. What we're talking about is portability of credits. And the concept is that if a student takes a credit at Hobart High School and it is part of our curriculum, they get a Purdue transcript, and that transcript then is portable if they were to go to, say, Ball State. And if it's part of the core transfer library, there is a legislative mandate which requires them to accept it. And the state actually just put some new measurements in place at the Transfer In website, which you can see at the bottom of my screen, and that's if his students run into problems such as this wasn't accepted, they chose not to accept this towards graduation, or just even accept it in general, then they can go to this website and actually lodge a complaint or a concern, and at that point it goes to one of our subcommittees. The subcommittee looks at it, and then we bring in the transfer institution and the accepting institution to make sure we can reconcile the differences. Recently, last September, we had a press release and we launched a new program for us. It's the 1+3 program. And the construct for that is that you can do 1 year in high school, and those credits would fit into a plan of study. Now, we've already met the state mandate on 120 credit hours. They called it the credit creep legislation, where some baccalaureate degrees were getting up to 126, 128, 132. And they said, no, bring it back down to 120 credit hours, that someone taking 30 credit hours in a year can graduate in 4 years. So I think the only courses, or the only programs of study, excuse me, that aren't at 120 would be engineering, which was an exception, and I believe education. Everything else is at 120, so we said, let's figure out how we can do that 1 year, that 30 hours. So what we did is we went out and we partnered with the following six high schools, and that's Chesterton, Michigan City, LaPorte, Portage, Valparaiso, and Westville. And we're currently, I think, maybe a class away from establishing a 1+3 with Hobart. And we're also working with Rolling Prairie High School as well. Now, when you think about this, you think, well, what is the impact that a 1+3 or concurrent enrollment has? That's what we refer to dual credit as concurrent enrollment, compared to a normal student. So as you can see in this one slide, or maybe you can't, but there's dual credit students, and it says dual credit students with a 3.0 high school GPA. What was their GPA at Purdue North Central? Students who came in with dual credit, they averaged a 1.3 GPA. Then we said, all right, let's look at students who had a 3.0 in high school but didn't have dual credit. What was their GPA at Purdue North Central? And it was a 2.7. And I think what we're talking about is engagement. And students who did dual credit are more engaged in their studies than students who didn't have dual credit. Right now, students roughly average about 6 credit hours, so that's about $1,400 for our students last semester as far as the savings that they would take away with. If someone were to enroll in the 1+3 program, it's roughly about $7,000 in savings that they would actually walk away with. There's some new legislation out there, and Eric Bann and I were talking. It's House Bill 1348, and I don't know, is anyone familiar with 1348? 1348 is going to affect everyone in Indiana, because what it does is it requires that Frank O'Bannon and 21st century scholars, when they matriculate to a state university, and even the privates, will have to net 30 credit hours at the end of every year. It's a lot different than what it used to be. There used to be a census after 4 weeks, and if they were enrolled in 12 credit hours after that census, then they met the financial aid requirement for both the federal and for the state. And if they dropped a course, let's just say in late October, that wasn't necessarily held against them. This will actually change that, because at the end of the year, they're going to look at credit hours completed, and it's part of the pathways or mapping process that they've built into this. And the universities have to offer the courses that allow a student to graduate. If we don't offer a course in a time frame or in the semester that we said we would in a plan of study, then the university pays for that course for the student. So it's going to be staged in this fall, and then it will go into full implementation come fall 14. Students who graduate in 4 years or complete 39 hours in a year will actually get $1,000 per year for every year that they complete 39 credits. And if they graduate on time, they'll get an additional $1,000. If they graduate in 3 years, like the 1+3, they would get an additional $1,500 back as part of their state aid. This is a plan of study that we work with, and it's just an example one from business. And you can see, or maybe you can't see, there's some blockings. There's four separate blockings. Each one of these represents a year. So we can see year one is done in the high school. Each one of these courses are offered in one of our partnership high schools, and then when they come on campus, we know that they're part of the 1+3 program through an intent form. The intent form is the old NCR. It's not actually carbon paper, but it's NCR, where the high school guidance office can keep this intent form in the student file, and then we can guarantee it, and it goes in our records, that when the student enrolls with a course attribute, or excuse me, a student attribute, we're able to track them through and make sure that the advisement directly intervenes and make sure that they're on track for that 3 year. Currently, we offer it in biology, human resources, business, and general education. And then we do accept alternative coursework, such as AP, CLEP, or even IB, and that would plug into then what could possibly be the 30 credit hours as part of the 120. We do require signatures of the student, parent, and counselor. And once again, this is built on the construct that the advisor is working or the counselor is working with the student as they progress through the 1+3. Next, what I'm going to talk about is the vision. And the vision is a new way of looking at things through the web. The web is certainly not new, but we do have a new web-based degree audit system. And when you think about degree audit systems at a university, you typically think, oh, once they become a degree-seeking student and they're on campus, they can check and see how these credits count towards graduation. What we're going to demonstrate for you is actually how a sophomore, junior, or senior could run if-then scenarios online with their Purdue login. And every student who is a concurrent or dual credit student has a login access so they can say, what if I was in biology? How many credits would count towards a degree, and what would it fulfill as part of the different degree requirements, such as Gen Ed, supplemental Gen Ed, or the core of the program? So what we're going to do is kind of talk about this web-based program, and I'm going to have my colleague come up and join me. And what we're going to do is kind of walk you through a demonstration, and Jen is our assistant registrar. And I do have to say that Jen is probably the foremost expert, at least on our campus, when it comes to degree audits. She actually built the curriculums, and if you've worked through curriculum changes in a given year with the Faculty Senate, it's kind of like a moving target. But she was able to do it and actually get it on track. So let me toggle over. Well, thank you, too, and see if I can actually get us into where we need to be. So that would be a login, which I just did, that any one of your students would be able to do, and they get that in their acceptance letter. They're going to come up on the portal. It's, of course, theirs is going to be a little bit different. They wouldn't get an advisor or faculty access. But what we're going to do is we're just going to log in as if we were a student, and I'll turn it over to Jen.
Okay. All right. So if your students are taking dual credit courses with Purdue North Central, they'll all have a login to our portal, and this is what you're seeing here. They can click right here on the DegreeWorks link, and this is the advising tool for all of our plans of study on campus. Okay, when they come in, their information is going to pop right up. So I'm going to put a student in because we have staff access. Okay, so this student, this is the degree audit that they will see. If they've declared a major, all of the information is right up here in the student information. This particular student, Mickey Mouse, we've put in the business major with a concentration in management. So all of the degree requirements are going to be listed below. They'll see their overall GPA at the university. Once they're assigned an advisor, they've got advisor information. They'll see their classification ID number. You scroll down. Okay. There is a progress bar right here which tells them how far along they are in their degree program. Now, this is based on the number of check boxes that are checked off below. If this student's in, well, this student is in the business major, they're 17% complete, and all of the degree requirements are listed below. It tells them right here they have 120 hours, that's what's required for this program, and how many attempted hours they have had. The first block that appears is the general education core. All of our programs have a gen ed core with approximately 30 hours. It tells them what semester they've taken the course, what their grades are, and then the green checkbox means that the course is actually completed. The blue squiggly lines, this is a work in progress, so this particular student has registered for coursework for the coming fall semester, and it's also checking off the requirements as they go towards the degree. At PNC, some of our programs have a supplemental core, and we built the degree works in blocks of courses. So we have Gen Ed core, supplemental core, and then the major requirements. If a student was trying to plan their schedule, they could actually hover over a course. This is called the course link. And if they're going to register for classes, if they've graduated high school and they're going to register for classes at PNC, they can go out here. They can see the catalog, description, any prerequisites that are required for the course, and actually see our year-long schedule. As you scroll down, this student has also elected to have a concentration in management on their degree, so those requirements do plug in as well. Now, a dual credit student most likely will not have declared a major, so they won't see anything when they first log in. But what they can use is this what-if scenario over here on the left. And all of our degrees pop up. So if they were looking at a Bachelor of Science degree in biology, they just click on their major. And we'll go ahead and even give them a minor in chemistry. And if they process the what-if, now they're 19% complete to that program and they're not even in it yet. You can see the requirements up here, they've changed it, biology and chemistry. And they can see how all of the courses that they've already taken and what they've already registered for are going to fit into the new programs. At the bottom, it just lists what they're registered for. Students can also use a GPA calculator with this. And any student can do this, because we have the student's overall information. This is just their PNC courses. They can come out here if they know they're registered. Actually, in a current semester, the courses will automatically populate in here, but they can also use this tool even before they're registered for classes, if they know how many credit hours the courses are. So say they're registered, we'll just put them in three credit hour courses, and they think they're going to get a B+. They think they're going to get an A. And they think they're going to get a C. They can see what the impact on their overall GPA is going to be. They can shop literally any degree that we offer. If they want to change it, they want to do something that's not even in the 1+3, they can do a Bachelor of Arts. They can come out and pick the major of communication and process a what if. Now they're 29% complete already to their degree. And they can look through all of our majors. We have lists over here of how the combinations go. What's under Bachelor of Arts, what's under Bachelor of Science. But pretty much that is the degree audit system. Anything else you wanted me to cover?
Any questions for Jen on degree audit?
Okay.
Well, and we think this is important because what we don't want to do is offer courses at your high schools and have those credits sit empty. Empty credits don't do anyone any good. And to be honest with you, as a commuter institution, we're better off when your students actually come in with more credit hours. We want them into higher level courses. We want them progressing. And it's to everyone's benefits, and what we don't want to do is have an angry parent at our door saying, well, we took these classes in high school and we thought it was counting, and say, well, you know, it's a completely different plan of study. You were following a liberal arts curriculum and now you want to go into electrical engineering. So this will actually give them a pathway or a mapping so they can be more specific. But I know that we will be in a breakout session after this. And what I'll do at this point is I'll turn it over to Dr. Summers, and she can talk about what they're doing at Ivy Tech, and we'll just continue with our presentation, and then afterwards we can go to a Q&A. I will.
Are you Good afternoon, everybody. I really appreciate Paul and his colleague sharing information about what Purdue North Center is doing in order to help accelerate students from high school to college. It's a big issue. And today my presentation will be a little bit different in terms of not really talking specifics about what we're doing at Ivy Tech now. We're doing dual credit and some of those kinds of very similar activities as Purdue North Central. What I really want to focus on is where we're going and how we really need to all get on board with where we're going to help students get college ready in a better way. So what does it mean to be college ready? We hear this all the time. There's wide consensus that we all want our students to be ready and able to pursue a college education beyond high school, but what does that mean? Does anybody want to share with me what they think college ready means? Is it ready to jump into calculus? Is it ready to, yes, Paul, you have the answer.
Yes.
Yes. It's a term we use a lot. And we don't understand all the time why we have such a problem. So I wanted to share a little bit with you what I've come to learn about why we talk about this so much. Probably 30 years ago, education looked very different to all of us. We had vocational education and we had college-bound students. And usually our high school students were one or the other, and we didn't really focus on a readiness issue for many, many of our students. And that was the way we did it, and that was how we approached education and higher education in our country. Somewhere in the 70s, I believe, maybe 80s, there was a huge momentum that everybody needed a college degree. I'm a Generation Xer, just at the oldest edge of the being a Generation X, and the message to me was, you're going to college. Don't know what you're going to do, but you're going to college, and that's it. So I went to college, and I was very typical at that time where I had no idea what I was going to do in college, and then traveled this path that was very winding to end up here at this podium. But around then and earlier, the message became, if you really want a good life, you need to go to college. So now the masses of our society were interested in becoming more and more interested in going to college. And what happened was that we started seeing a whole different group of students wanting to go to college, which is a good thing. And now more students are showing up at the college door, which means that more students not ready are showing up at the college door. And this is a very quick scenario of what's happened in our society. It's a good thing. It's a good thing that we emphasize that everybody needs a post-secondary education in our society. That's the message we want all students to get as we move forward. And that's why it's sometimes a problem too, because we have so many more students wanting to go to college. Community colleges' role in college readiness. Nationally, community colleges have become the player in our priority. We have the greatest potential at community colleges. Right now, we're almost exclusively offering remediation and developmental education for those students that are not college ready. And Ivy Tech is no exception. We spend a lot of time, energy, and effort to help students get ready for college. It's what we do, and almost in Northwest Indiana, we are the primary provider for developmental and remedial education. So how does this impact the high schools? This is a high school event, so we could talk a lot about all the students at Ivy Tech, but I really just want to talk about the Ivy Tech students that come from the high schools and how we can get more of those students to our door and to their college degrees and their goals that they're setting for themselves. I believe that our relationship should be all around college and career planning. I am a big proponent of developmental guidance. I don't know if we use that term so much anymore, but I really like the concept of having students really begin their career exploration in middle school or earlier. And when I say middle school, it's really much more concrete than talking about careers. It's really getting involved and getting to employers and learning more about them. Dual credit in early college, again, we have a great example of what PNC is doing. Ivy Tech, we're doing so much with dual credit right now. Our heads are spinning. We're in every single high school in the region except for two right now, and that's been through a lot of effort on your parts to help us to bring those classes to you in your classrooms. Career pathways and programs of study. We have a lot of work to do in this area, and this is where the colleges and the high schools need to work together and spend a lot more time. Again, going back to what PNC is doing, the map, the blueprint, the pathway, it's all there so the student can see it. We need to refine those. We need to create more of them, and they need to be specific. Now, I've talked to many of you in the high schools, and I see these great pathways in your own high schools that are really clear for students. They're geared around the career clusters. They're very refined, but we don't have that connection to Ivy Tech. And we need to make that link. We need to have that dual credit be meaningful, and I'll get to that in a minute. Assessment, always our favorite topic as educators. We have to assess what we're doing and what the students are doing all the time. Otherwise, we're not going to know if we're doing the right thing. Remediation, I talked a little bit about that. That's a big part of the College Ready agenda. Our goal is to eliminate it, to have no need for remediation. And then workforce readiness and job placement is a big part of how we need to work together, the high schools in Ivy Tech. College and career planning. Comprehensive and developmental approach to preparing students earlier, as I hinted. Let's do it earlier. Let's get them engaged earlier so that, you know, we can help them along their path and have them decide on the classes that they want to take that'll help them. I'm here as an educator today. I am a 20-year veteran in the community college system, and I firmly believe in the community college system as a really great hope for our better society and to educate the masses in our country. I'm also here as a parent, and that's why I love and I feel so passionate about these kinds of conversations, because I have, next in the fall, I have a junior and a sophomore. One's a boy, one's a girl, and I have the spectrum in terms of what they're thinking and talking and planning for their college education. One of them, my younger one, is really determined and knows what he wants to do, and he's got a really good clear-cut academic plan for that, and I love it. I have another one, my daughter, and she is good at everything and wants to do everything, but she doesn't have a clear-cut plan, and I'm concerned about that. So that's when I talked to the high school counselors, what are we doing to help her plan? Because if she's going into something STEM-related, she really needs to be pathing towards a higher math in high school to be prepared. We have to have those conversations. Parents need to be involved. Teachers need to be involved. Post-secondary needs to be involved. It really is going to take a lot of us to get to that place where we're really helping students get ready for college. Work-based learning, what is it? Job shadowing, bringing employers into your classrooms. I can't say it enough that is so valuable for students to learn about careers. Right now, the bulk of our high school students in our country learn about careers from what they see on television. So everybody wants to be a lawyer or a police officer or a firefighter. You know, we don't have really good comedies about people who work in the steel mills. Usually teachers are portrayed in more of a negative way on television. You know, we've got to really talk to students about what it is that they want to do, but bringing those employers and business folks into the classrooms to have those conversations. We also need to get our younger students out to the business place. We need to have them see what it's like to work every single day in a steel mill, in a hospital, in a school, in a firehouse, in a corporation, wherever they choose. It would be so great if we can get the students younger and younger into those places. We need to develop these plans early. Ninth grade, every student should have a plan that tracks all the way through K-14 or K-16, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. Dual credit in early college. We have to know our students. I'm a big proponent of knowing our students. Again, let's talk to them. What are their goals? Where do they see themselves? Meaningful dual credit for all. We talk about dual credit a lot, but what is meaningful dual credit? Dual credit that's meaningful is actually part of that pathway to a degree. It is very clear cut what that dual credit does. And again, going back to the example of my own child, she's a straight A student, she's high honors, and she has opportunity for a lot of dual credit in the high school where she goes to, except for it's not very meaningful. You know, after her junior year, she'll have like 9 to 12 credits or more in history. it's great, history, I love history, but she'll have no credits in anything else but history because of the relationship between the high school and the community college. They're not really talking about what's meaningful. And I had a talk with the assistant principal, and she kind of looked at me, she's like, you know, you're right. They really should have the broader scope of classes in high school for the high honor students. That's English, math, psychology, and history. But they're not at that point yet. And that's why I think we need to talk about it more. It's just not good enough. It's good, not good enough to take dual credit and throw it against the wall and see what sticks and what might help a student down the road. We need to say every day at Ivy Tech and in your high schools, why are we doing this and what's it going to do for a student down the road? Have those students complete big portions of their degree before they leave high school. And they will be very ready because they are already in college. So those are the kinds of things we need to talk about all the time. So we have CTE students and transfer students. I'm going to talk about those a little bit in particular. Community colleges. I know in Indiana, community college, that concept is still relatively new. Community colleges have a dual role for most of our students. Many of the students that choose community colleges choose them to go because they want to transfer to Purdue North Central or Purdue in Lafayette or IU or somewhere else, Ball State, wherever it is, they will choose Ivy Tech first and then go. And this is something we need to work on in our region here too, to help students understand that process. And they should have a very specific plan in high school if this is what they want to do. And many of them do, generally speaking. But let's put dual credit in there in a little bit more intentional way for those students. They want to pursue bachelor's degrees for jobs that require bachelor's degrees. An example core for a student interested in transfer. What we should do, we should have our dual credit in math, English, speech, psychology, sociology, or history, college success, humanities and language, physical or environmental or natural sciences. Those are the kinds of things that we should really work together with our high schools and colleges to get people to the door of college ready. The CTE student, the last slide was our AS student, our Associate of Science student. They are the transfer student. The CTE student is our AAS student, the Associate of Applied Science student. And these students want to go to work after 2 years of college. They want to be the nurses. They want to work in the steel mill. They want to work in early childhood education, computer technology, and more. About 70% of all jobs in our country tie to an associate degree. They do not require more than an associate degree. And this is where a lot of us get confused. There are so many great career paths for students that an AAS is the right degree. And we need to have those conversations with students too. And again, meaningful dual credit. Anatomy and physiology and biology, medical terminology, introduction to health career, student success, speech, English, quantitative reasoning, and that's our new math course that we're developing. These are for students interested in health, and how do we build these in your school? Can we do this? Can we get all these dual credit courses in your high schools and have the students receive their high school credit for it as well? That's what our goal should be. Example core for students interested in industrial technology. Again, safety, print reading, intro to electricity, fluid power basics, student success, English, math, speech. These are all cores for students that are interested in industrial technology. And this is what we should be offering in our high schools, and we should really try to get these in our high schools. We're talking with the steel mills all the time about these great jobs and $90,000 a year and all the things that can happen for someone with a very short-term degree. And if we get them done in high school or a large portion of it, they'll get there faster. Again, using the CTE core in the comprehensive pathway is really what we want to do in terms of working together and collaborating. We need to develop these pathways and we need to develop them sooner. Okay, the big white elephant in the room. 70% of the students that don't show up college ready are not ready in math and English. This is what we talk about over and over again. And I guess tomorrow is going to be focusing on math. That's great. We have to talk about math a lot because that's the bigger area where our students show up not ready, math. And we are talking about this and talking about this and talking about this all the time at Ivy Tech. How do we bridge that gap and what can we do? We have an Accuplacer assessment, and this is the assessment that students who are interested in coming to Ivy Tech take so that they can find their place in a math class. It has a diagnostic tool that we're experimenting with that we hope will be something that will help be a better tool for students. Again, we're really trying to minimize the amount of remediation and developmental education that's needed, but we can't compromise that readiness factor. We cannot be putting students into classes that they're not ready to take. We do have a problem with prerequisites, and we're going to be addressing that at Ivy Tech. Right now, we have the Accuplacer available to students, and then we put all kinds of other courses in there other than math and English. The Accuplacer essentially is testing for math and English, and we have to ask those very hard questions. Does a student need to have a certain math and English score to take all of our classes? And we're asking that question because many would argue no. We have a whole bunch of 100 level courses that students can take while they're getting math and English ready. And we're going to be talking about that a lot at Ivy Tech over the next couple of years. Remediation, again, academic skills achievement is what we call it at Ivy Tech. We are now full blown into what we call the co-requisite model. From here on in, beginning this year for us, students who are not ready for math and English will be co-reqed in their schedule. And that means they're going to take the developmental course and their college level course at the same time. I want to work with the high schools to figure out how we can do this in the high schools, how we can create bridge programs in the summer. I want to cohort students in the summer to get this work done because it's going to be intense, but they'll be further along in their educational goals when we get, when we successfully implement the co-requisite model. Cohorts, I like cohorts. I like students that are grouped together that can create a support system. We're working on one right now at Ivy Tech Northwest. It's called a Take Five, where they're co-reqed in math, co-requed in English, and taking student success in the summer. It's a little intense, but they're a cohort, and we're keeping them together and providing a lot of student support services. Again, tutoring, mentoring, all kinds of things. So we have to move forward. We have to keep going. As I say to people all the time, being in the community college system in Illinois for 20 years or so, I'm very used to their model. And Illinois has its own issues with money and things going sideways. In Indiana, we are going forward in a very, very positive way. And I'm really looking forward to taking this agenda and getting in the trenches with educators to build these pathways to help us really help our students succeed. I have a lot more I could say about it. I know we're time tight, so we will move on to the question and answer or into the other next phase of the conference. I'm really glad to be here. Again, I worked a lot with high schools in my career, and I'm hoping to work a lot more with all of you in the future. Thank you.